This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The colonial history of the United States covers the history of European settlements from the start of colonization of America until their incorporation into the United States in the late 16th century. England, France, Spain, and the Netherlands launched major colonization programs in eastern North America. Small early attempts often disappeared, such as the English lost colony of Roanoke everywhere. The death rate was very high among the first arrivals. Nevertheless, successful colonies were established. European settlers came from a variety of social and religious groups. Few aristocrats settled permanently, but a number of adventurers, soldiers, farmers, and tradesmen arrived. Diversity was an American characteristic as settlers came to the new continent, including the Dutch of New Netherland, the Swedes and Finns of New Sweden, the English Quakers of Pennsylvania, the English Puritans of New England, the English settlers of Jamestown, and the worthy poor of Georgia. They built colonies with distinctive social, religious, political, and economic styles. Non-British colonies were taken over and the inhabitants were all assimilated. Unlike in Nova Scotia, where the British expelled the French Acadian inhabitants, there were no major civil wars among the 13. Caribbean wars were recurrent between the French and the British, the French and Indian wars especially, and involved French support for Wabanaki attacks on the frontiers. By 1760, France was defeated and the British seized its colonies on the eastern seaboard of what became the United States. The four distinct British regions were, New England, the Middle Colonies, the Chesapeake Bay Colonies Upper South, and the Lower South. Some historians add a fifth region of the frontier which was never separately organized by the time that European settlers arrived around 1600 to 1650, a significant percentage of the Native Americans living in the eastern United States had been ravaged by new diseases, possibly introduced to them decades before by explorers and sailors. See Timeline of Colonial America for list of historical events. Contents 1. The goals of colonization. 11. Mercantilism. 12. Freedom from religious persecution. 2. Early colonial failures. 3. Spanish viceroyalties. 31. Florida. 32. New Mexico. 33. California. 34. Texas. 4. New France. 41. Pays d'en Haut. 42. Illinois Country. 43. Louisiana. 5. New Netherlands. 6. New Sweden. 7. Russian colonies. 8. English colonies. 81. Chesapeake Bay Area. 8. 11. Virginia. 82. New England. 821. Puritans. 822. Other New England. 823. Dominion of New England. 83. Middle colonies. 84. South. 841 Chesapeake Society. 842 Carolinas. 843 Georgia. 844 East and West Florida. 9 British Colonial Government. 91 Crown Colonies. 92 Proprietary Colonies. 93 Charter Colonies. 94 Political Culture. 10 Unification of the British Colonies. 101 Colonial Wars, A Common Defense. 1011 French and Indian War. 102 Ties to the British Empire. 1021 Republicanism. 1022 Consumption of British Goods. 103 Atlantic World. 11 Tax protests lead to revolution. 12 Colonial life. 121 Medical conditions. 122 Religion. 1221 Great Awakening. 123 Women's roles. 124 Slaves. 125 New England. 1251 Farm and family life. 1252 Town life. 1253 Culture and education. 1254 Religion. 13 Mid-Atlantic region. 131 Ways of life. 132 Farming. 133 Seaports. 134 Southern colonies. 1341 Women in the South. 14 See also. 15 Footnotes. 16 Bibliography. 161 Reference books. 162 Surveys. 163 Special topics. 164 Primary sources. 165 Online sources. 17 External links. The goals of colonization. Colonizers came from European kingdoms that had highly developed military, naval, governmental, and entrepreneurial capabilities. The Spanish and Portuguese centuries-old experience of conquest and colonization during the Reconquista, coupled with new oceanic ship navigation skills, provided the tools, ability, and desire to colonize the New World. These efforts were managed respectively by the Casa de Contratación and the Casa da India. England, France, and the Netherlands had also started colonies in both the West Indies and North America. They had the ability to build ocean-worthy ships but did not have as strong a history of colonization in foreign lands as did Portugal and Spain. However, English entrepreneurs gave their colonies a foundation of merchant-based investment that seemed to need much less government support. Initially, matters concerning the colonies were dealt with primarily by the Privy Council and its committees. The Commission of Trade was set up in 1625 as the first special body convened to advise on colonial plantation questions from 1696 until the end of the Revolution. Colonial affairs were the responsibility of the Board of Trade in partnership with the relevant Secretaries of State, which changed from the Secretary of State for the Southern Department to the Secretary of State for the Colonies in 1768. Mercantilism was the basic policy imposed by Britain on its colonies from the 1660s. Mercantilism meant that the government and merchants based in England became partners with the goal of increasing political power and private wealth, to the exclusion of other empires and even merchants based in its own colonies. The government protected its London-based merchants and kept out others by trade barriers, regulations, and subsidies to domestic industries in order to maximize exports from the realm and minimize imports. The government had to fight smuggling, especially by American merchants, some of whose activities were classified as smuggling by the Navigation Acts, including direct trade with the French, Spanish, Dutch, and Portuguese. The goal of mercantilism was to run trade surpluses, so that gold and silver would pour into London. The government took its share through duties and taxes, with the remainder going to merchants in Britain. The government spent much of its revenue on a superb Royal Navy, which protected the British colonies and also threatened the colonies of the other empires, sometimes even seizing them. Thus, the British Navy captured New Amsterdam, New York in 1664. The colonies were captive markets for British industry, and the goal was to enrich the mother country. Freedom from religious persecution. The prospect of religious persecution by authorities of the Crown and the Church of England prompted a significant number of colonization efforts. People fleeing persecution by King Charles I were responsible for settling most of New England, and the province of Maryland was founded in part to be a haven for Roman Catholics. Early colonial failures. Anonymous Portuguese explorers were the first Europeans to map the future eastern seaboard of the U.S. from New York to Florida, as documented in the Cantino Planisphere of 1502. However, they kept their discoveries a secret and did not attempt to settle in North America, as the Inter Cetera issued by Pope Alexander VI in 1493 had granted these lands to Spain. Other countries did attempt to found colonies in what later became the United States over the following century, and most of these attempts ended in failure. The colonists faced high rates of death due to many reasons, including disease, starvation, inefficient resupply, conflict with Native Americans, and attacks by rival European powers. Spain had numerous failed attempts, including San Miguel de Guadalupe in Georgia 1526, Pánfilo de Narváez's expedition to Florida's Gulf Coast 1528-36, Pensacola in West Florida 1559-61, Fort San Juan in North Carolina 1567-68, and the Ajacon Mission in Virginia 1570-71. The French failed at Paris Island, South Carolina 1562-63, Fort Caroline on Florida's Atlantic Coast 1564-65, St. Croix Island, Maine 1604-05, and Fort St. Louis, Texas 1685-89. The most notable English failures were the Lost Colony of Roanoke 1587-90 in North Carolina and Popham Colony in Maine 1607-08. It was at the Roanoke Colony that Virginia Dare became the first English child born in the Americas. Her fate is unknown. Spanish Viceroyalty's main articles, Viceroyalty of New Spain and Spanish Colony Colonization of the Americas. The Spaniard Juan Ponce de León named and explored Florida between 1765 and 1803. Spain claimed North America west of the Mississippi River and south of British Canada. Additionally, east of the Mississippi River, Spain claimed what is now the state of Florida and parts of Alabama, Georgia, Louisiana, and Mississippi. It had actual control of New Orleans and a few other towns scattered across this vast domain. The Castillo de San Marcos, built to defend Spanish St. Augustine, Florida. Construction began in 1672. Florida. Main articles, History of Florida and Spanish Florida. Spain established several small outposts in Florida in the early 16th century. The most important of these was St. Augustine, founded in 1565 but repeatedly attacked and burned by pirates, privateers, and English forces. Its buildings survived, even as nearly all the Spanish left. It claims to be the oldest European settlement in the continental United States. The British attacked Spanish Florida during numerous wars as early as 1687, the Spanish government had begun to offer asylum to slaves from British colonies. In 1693, the Spanish crown officially proclaimed that runaways would find freedom in Florida, in return for converting to Catholicism and a term for men of 4 years' military service to the crown. In effect, Spain created a Maroon settlement in Florida as a frontline defense against English attacks from the north. Spain also intended to destabilize the plantation economy of the British colonies by creating a free black community to attract slaves seeking escape and refuge from the British slavery. In 1763, Spain traded Florida to Great Britain in exchange for control of Havana, Cuba, which had been captured by the British during the Seven Years' War. Florida was home to about 3,000 Spaniards at the time, and nearly all quickly left Britain-occupied Florida, but did not send many settlers to the area, and control was restored to Spain in 1783 by the Peace of Paris, which ended the American Revolutionary War. Spain sent no more settlers or missionaries to Florida during this second colonial period. The inhabitants of West Florida revolted against the Spanish in 1810 and formed the Republic of West Florida, which was quickly annexed by the United States. The United States took possession of East Florida in 1821 according to the terms of the Adams-Onis Treaty. New Mexico. Main article: History of New Mexico. Throughout the 16th century, Spain explored the southwest from Mexico, with the most notable explorer being Francisco Coronado, whose expedition rode throughout modern New Mexico and Arizona. The Spanish moved north from Mexico, settling villages in the upper valley of the Rio Grande, including much of the western half of the present-day state of New Mexico. The capital was Santa Fe. Local Indians expelled the Spanish for 12 years following the Pueblo Revolt of 1680. They returned in 1692 The bloodless reoccupation of Santa Fe. Control was by Spain 223 years and Mexico 25 years until 1846, when the American Army of the West took over in the Mexican-American War. About a third of the population in the 21st century is descended from the Spanish settlers. California. Main article: History of California through 1899. Further information: Spanish missions in California and territorial evolution of California. The ruins of the Spanish mission San Juan Capistrano in California. Spanish explorers sailed along the coast of present-day California from the early 16th century to the mid-18th century, but no settlements were established over those centuries. From 1769 until the independence of Mexico in 1820, Spain sent missionaries and soldiers to Alta California, who created a series of missions operated by Franciscan priests. They also operated presidios, forts, pueblos, settlements, and ranchos, land grant ranches, along the southern and central coast of California. Father Junipero Serra founded the first missions in Spanish Upper Las Californias, starting with Mission San Diego de Alcala in 1769. Through the Spanish and Mexican eras, they eventually comprised a series of 21 missions to spread Christianity among the local Native Americans, linked by El Camino Real, the Royal Road. They were established to convert the indigenous peoples of California, while protecting historic Spanish claims to the area. The missions introduced European technology, livestock, and crops. The Indian reductions converted the native peoples into groups of mission Indians. They worked as laborers in the missions and the ranchos. In the 1830s, the missions were disbanded and the lands sold to Californios. The indigenous Native American population was around 150,000, the Californios Mexican era Californians around 10,000, with the rest immigrant Americans and other nationalities involved in trade and business in California. Texas. Further information: Spanish Texas and Spanish missions in Texas. New France. Main articles: New France and French colonization of the Americas. The 1750 possessions of Britain pink, France blue, and Spain orange. In contrast to the borders of contemporary Canada and the United States, New France was the vast area centered on the Mississippi River that was explored and claimed by France starting in the mid-17th century. It was composed of several colonies: Acadia, Canada, Newfoundland, Louisiana, Île Royale present-day Cape Breton Island, and Île Saint-Jean present-day Prince Edward Island. All of these territories came under British control in the 18th century, but only portions of Canada, Acadia, and Louisiana became parts of the United States. Pays Don Hot. By 1660, French fur trappers, missionaries, and military detachments based in Montreal pushed west along the Great Lakes upriver into the Pays Don Hot and founded outposts at Green Bay, Fort de Buade and St. Ignace, both at Michilimackinac, Sault Ste. Marie, Vincennes, and Detroit in 1701. During the French and Indian War 1754-1763, many of these settlements became Occupied by the British by 1773, the population of Detroit was 1,400 at the end of the War for Independence in 1783. The region south of the Great Lakes formally became part of the United States Illinois Country. The Illinois Country by 1752 had a French population of 2,500. It was located to the west of the Ohio Country and was concentrated around Kaskaskia, Cahokia, and St. Genevieve. According to one scholar, the Illinois habitant was a gay soul. He seemed shockingly carefree to later, self-righteous Puritans from the American colonies. Louisiana French claims to French Louisiana stretched thousands of miles from modern Louisiana north to the largely unexplored Midwest, and west to the Rocky Mountains. It was generally divided into Upper and Lower Louisiana. This vast tract was first settled at Mobile and Biloxi around 1700, and continued to grow when 7,000 French immigrants founded New Orleans in 1718. Settlement proceeded very slowly. New Orleans became an important port as the gateway to the Mississippi River, but there was little other economic development because the city lacked a prosperous hinterland. In 1763, Louisiana was ceded to Spain around New Orleans and west of the Mississippi River. In the 1780s, the western border of the newly independent United States stretched to the Mississippi River. The United States reached an agreement with Spain for navigation rights on the river and was content to let the feeble colonial power stay in control of the area. The situation changed when Napoleon forced Spain to return Louisiana to France in 1802 and threatened to close the river to American vessels. Alarmed, the United States offered to buy New Orleans. Napoleon needed funds to wage another war with Great Britain, and he doubted that France could defend such a huge and distant territory. He therefore offered to sell all of Louisiana for $15 million. The United States completed the Louisiana Purchase in 1803, doubling the size of the nation. New Netherland. Main articles, New Netherland and Dutch colonization of the Americas. New Netherland series. Exploration. Fortifications, Fort Amsterdam, Fort Nassau North, Fort Orange, Fort Nassau South, Fort Gaeta, Hoop de Wall, Fort Casimir, Fort Altina, Fort Wilhelmus, Fort Beverschreed, Fort Nya, Korshom de Rondout. Settlements, Noten, Aylant, New Amsterdam, Rensselaerswijk, New Haarlem, Beverwijk, Wiltwijk, Bergen, Pavonia, Vriesendale. Actor, Colonel Vlissingen, Oud Dorp, Colon Donk, Greenwich, Heemstede, Rustdorp, Gravesende, Broekelen, New Amersfoort, Midwout, New Utrecht, Boswijk, Swanendale, New Amstel, New Dorp. The Patroon System. Charter of Freedoms and Exemptions. Cornelius Jacobson, May 1620-25, Willem Verhulst 1625-26, Peter Minuit 1626-32, Sebastian Janssen Krol 1632-33, Wouter van Twiller 1633-38, Willem Kieft 1638-47, Peter Stuyvesant 1647-64. People of New Netherland. New Netherlander. 12 men, 8 men, 9 men. Flushing Remonstrance. VEA map of New Amsterdam in 1660. New Netherland, or New Netherland, was a colonial province of the Republic of the Seven United Netherlands, chartered in 1614, in what became New York State, New Jersey, and parts of other neighboring states. The peak population was less than 10,000. The Dutch established a patroon system with feudal-like rights given to a few powerful landholders. They also established religious tolerance and free trade. The colony's capital of New Amsterdam was founded in 1625 and located at the southern tip of the island of Manhattan, which grew to become a major world city. The city was captured by the English in 1660. They took complete control of the colony in 1674 and renamed it New York. However, the Dutch landholdings remained, and the Hudson River Valley maintained a traditional Dutch character until the 1820s. Traces of Dutch influence remain in present-day northern New Jersey and southeastern New York State, such as homes, family surnames, and the names of roads and whole towns. New Sweden. Main articles, New Sweden and Swedish colonization of the Americas. Map of New Sweden by Amandus Johnson. New Sweden. Swedish, NYA. Sverige was a Swedish colony that existed along the Delaware River Valley from 1638 to 1655 and encompassed land in present-day Delaware, southern New Jersey, and southeastern Pennsylvania. The several hundred settlers were centered around the capital of Fort Christina, at the location of what is today the city of Wilmington, Delaware. The colony also had settlements near the present-day location of Salem, New Jersey. Fort Nya, Elfsborg, and on Tinicum Island, Pennsylvania. The colony was captured by the Dutch in 1655 and merged into New Netherland, with most of the colonists remaining years later. The entire New Netherland colony was incorporated into England's colonial holdings. The colony of New Sweden introduced Lutheranism to America in the form of some of the continent's oldest European churches. The colonists also introduced the log cabin to America, and numerous numerous rivers, towns, and families in the lower Delaware River Valley region derive their names from the Swedes. The Nothnagel Log House in present-day Gibbstown, New Jersey was constructed in the late 1630s during the time of the New Sweden Colony. It remains the oldest European-built house in New Jersey and is believed to be one of the oldest surviving log houses in the United States. Russian colonies. Main articles, Russian America and Russian colonization of the Americas. Russia explored the area that became Alaska, starting with the Second Kamchatka Expedition in the 1730s and early 1740s. Their first settlement was founded in 1784 by Grigory Shelikov. The Russian American Company was formed in 1799 with the influence of Nikolai Rezanov, for the purpose of buying sea otters for their fur from native hunters. In 1867, the U.S. purchased Alaska, and nearly all Russians abandoned the area except a few missionaries of the Russian Orthodox Church working among the natives. English colonies. See also, English Overseas Possessions, British America, and 13 Colonies. The 1606 grants by James I to the London and Plymouth Companies. The overlapping area yellow was granted to both companies on the stipulation that neither found a settlement within 100 miles 160. Chesapeake Bay Area. Main articles, Jamestown, Virginia, Colony of Virginia, and Province of Maryland. Virginia. The first successful English colony was Jamestown, established May 14, 1607 near Chesapeake Bay. The business venture was financed and coordinated by the London Virginia Company, a joint stock company looking for gold. Its first years were extremely difficult, with very high death rates from disease and starvation, wars with local Indians, and little gold. The colony survived and flourished by turning to tobacco as a cash crop by the late 17th century. Virginia's export economy was largely based on tobacco, and new, richer settlers came in to take up large portions of land, build large plantations, and import indentured servants and slaves. In 1676, Bacon's Rebellion occurred, but was suppressed by royal officials. After Bacon's Rebellion, African slaves rapidly replaced indentured servants as Virginia's main labor force. The colonial assembly shared power with a royally appointed governor on a more local level. Governmental power was invested in county courts, which were self-perpetuating. The incumbents filled any vacancies, and there never were popular elections as cash crop producers. Chesapeake plantations were heavily dependent on trade with England. With easy navigation by river, there were few towns and no cities. Planters shipped directly to Britain. High death rates and a very young population profile characterized the colony during its first years. New England. Main articles, History of New England, Connecticut Colony, Plymouth Colony, Massachusetts Bay Colony, Province of New Hampshire, and Colony of Rhode Island. Puritans. Main article, Puritan. A subset of the Puritans were the Separatists, Puritans who felt that they needed to separate themselves from the Church of England. It were those who traveled on the Mayflower in 1620 to escape religious persecution in England, today referred to as the Pilgrims, who established the first New England colony in Plymouth. Others came from England to Plymouth in the ensuing years, establishing the community which today is referred to as the Pilgrim Fathers. The non-separatist Puritans constituted a much larger group than the Pilgrims, and they established the Massachusetts Bay Colony in 1629 with 400 settlers. They sought to reform the Church of England by creating a new, pure church in the New World. By 1640, 20,000 had arrived. Many died soon after arrival, but the others found a healthy climate and an ample food supply. The Plymouth and Massachusetts Bay colonies together spawned other Puritan colonies in New England, including the New Haven, Saybrook, and Connecticut colonies. During the 17th century, the New Haven and Saybrook colonies were absorbed by Connecticut. The Puritans created a deeply religious, socially tight-knit, and politically innovative culture that still influences the modern United States. They hoped that this new land would serve as a redeemer nation. They fled England and attempted to create a nation of saints or a city upon a hill in America, an intensely religious, thoroughly righteous community designed to be an example for all of Europe. Roger Williams was a Puritan who preached religious toleration, separation of church and state, and a complete break with the Church of England. He was banished from the Massachusetts Bay Colony and founded Providence Plantation, which became a haven for other refugees. Anne Hutchinson and others shortly after established new settlements on the island in Narragansett Bay, which was called Rhode Island at the time, Newport, Rhode Island today. Economically, Puritan New England fulfilled the expectations of its founders. The Puritan economy was based on the efforts of self-supporting farmsteads who traded only for goods which they could not produce themselves. Unlike the cash crop-oriented plantations of the Chesapeake region, there was a generally higher economic standing and standard of living in New England than in the Chesapeake. New England became an important mercantile and shipbuilding center, along with agriculture, fishing, and logging, serving as the hub for trading between the southern colonies and Europe other New England. The Pilgrims were a small group of Puritan separatists based in England and the Netherlands. The initial group sailed on the Mayflower and settled in Plymouth, Massachusetts in 1620. They drew up the Mayflower Compact, by which they bound themselves together as a united community, thus establishing the small Plymouth colony. William Bradford was their main leader. Providence Plantation was founded in 1636 by Roger Williams on land provided by Narragansett Sachem. Canonicus Williams had been banished from the Massachusetts Bay Colony over theological disagreements, and he agreed with his fellow settlers on an egalitarian constitution providing for majority rule in civil things and liberty of conscience in religious matters. Other colonists settled to the north, mingling with adventurers and profit-oriented settlers to establish more religiously diverse colonies in New Hampshire and Maine. These small settlements were absorbed by Massachusetts when it made significant land claims in the 1640s and 1650s, but New Hampshire was eventually given a separate charter in 1679. Maine remained a part of Massachusetts until achieving statehood in 1820. Dominion of New England under King James II of England, the New England colonies, New York, and the Jerseys were briefly united as the Dominion of New England 1686-89. The administration was eventually led by Governor Sir Edmund Andros and seized colonial charters, revoked land titles, and ruled without local assemblies, causing anger among the population. The 1689 Boston Revolt was inspired by England's Glorious Revolution against James II and led to the arrest of Andros, Boston Anglicans, and senior Dominion officials by the Massachusetts militia. Andros was jailed for several months, then returned to England. The Dominion of New England was dissolved and governments resumed under their earlier charters. However, the Massachusetts charter had been revoked in 1684, and a new one was issued in 1691 that combined Massachusetts and Plymouth into the province of Massachusetts Bay. King William III sought to unite the New England colonies militarily by appointing the Earl of Bellomont to three simultaneous governorships and military command over Connecticut and Rhode Island. However, these attempts failed at unified control. Middle Colonies. Main article, Middle Colonies. The Middle Colonies consisted of the present-day states of New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware and were characterized by a large degree of diversity, religious, political, economic, and ethnic. The Dutch colony of New Netherland was taken over by the British and renamed New York. However, large numbers of Dutch remained in the colony, dominating the rural areas between New York City and Albany. Meanwhile, Yankees from New England started moving in, as did immigrants from Germany. New York City attracted a large polyglot population, including a large black slave population. New Jersey began as a division of New York, and was divided into the proprietary colonies of East and West Jersey for a time. Pennsylvania was founded in 1681 as a proprietary colony of Quaker William Penn. The main population elements included Quaker population based in Philadelphia, a Scotch-Irish population on the western frontier, and numerous German colonies in between. Philadelphia became the largest city in the colonies with its central location, excellent port, and a population of about 30,000 by the mid-18th century. Pennsylvania was basically a middle-class colony with limited deference to the small upper class. A writer in the Pennsylvania Journal summed it up in 1756, "The people of this province are generally of the middling sort, and at present pretty much upon a level. They are chiefly industrious farmers, artificers or men in trade. They enjoy and are fond of freedom, and the meanest among them thinks he has a right to civility from the greatest South." The predominant culture of the South was rooted in the settlement of the region by British colonists in the 17th century. Most voluntary immigrants were of English origins who settled chiefly along the coastal regions of the eastern seaboard. The majority of early British settlers were indentured servants, who gained freedom after enough work to pay off their passage. The wealthier men who paid their way received land grants known as headrights to encourage settlement. The French and Spanish established colonies in Florida, Louisiana, and Texas. The Spanish colonized Florida in the 16th century, with their communities reaching a peak in the late 17th century in the British and French colonies. Most immigrants arrived after 1700. They cleared land, built houses and outbuildings, and worked on the large plantations that dominated export agriculture. Many were involved in the labor-intensive cultivation of tobacco, the first cash crop of Virginia. With a decrease in the number of British willing to go to the colonies in the 18th century, planters began importing more enslaved Africans, who became the predominant labor force on the plantations. Tobacco exhausted the soil quickly, requiring new fields to be cleared on a regular basis. Old fields were used as pasture and for for crops such as corn and wheat, or allowed to grow into woodlots also in the 17th century. Colonists started importing African laborers in the coastal and other settlements. Early workers lived closely together in a multiracial society. Europeans married and made unions with Africans and Native Americans. The colonies gradually passed laws that hardened early conditions of indenture into lifelong racial slavery attached to African descent. Africans contributed to the economy of rice and indigo cultivation with their skilled knowledge, technology and labor, as well as to all the commodity crops, and to every aspect of culture. Food, music, stories and religion. Rice cultivation in South Carolina became another major commodity crop. Some historians have argued that slaves from the lowlands of Western Africa, where rice was a basic crop, provided key skills, knowledge and technology for irrigation and construction of earthworks to support rice cultivation. The early methods and tools used in South Carolina were congruent with those in Africa. British immigrants would have had little or no familiarity with the complex process of growing rice in fields flooded by irrigation works. Africans were instrumental in the development of major earthworks for cultivating these commodities, as well as in the knowledge of technology and techniques for processing the earthworks included extensive, elaborate systems of dams and irrigation for rice in the mid to late 18th century. Large groups of Scots and Ulster Scots, later called the Scots Irish, immigrated and settled in the backcountry of Appalachia and the Piedmont. They were the largest group of immigrants from the British Isles before the American Revolution. In a census taken in 2000 of Americans and their self-reported ancestries, areas where people reported American ancestry were the places where, historically, many Scottish, Scotch-Irish and English borderer Protestants settled in America, the interior as well as some of the coastal areas of the South, and especially the Appalachian region. The population with some Scots and Scots-Irish ancestry may number 47 million, as most people have multiple heritages, some of which they may not know. The early colonists, especially the Scots-Irish in the backcountry, engaged in warfare, trade, and cultural exchanges. Those living in the backcountry were more likely to join with Creek Indians, Cherokee, and Choctaws and other regional native groups. The oldest university in the South, the College of William Prestige. They controlled the local Anglican church, choosing ministers and handling church property and disbursing local charity. They sought election to the House of Purchases or appointment as Justice of the Peace. About 60% of white Virginians were part of a broad middle class that owned substantial farms by the second generation. Death rates from malaria and other local diseases had declined so much that a stable family structure was possible. The bottom third owned no land and verged on poverty. Many were recent arrivals, recently released from indentured servitude in some districts near present-day Washington, D.C. 70% of the land was owned by a handful of families, and three-fourths of the whites had no land at all. Large numbers of Irish and German Protestants had settled in the frontier districts, often moving down from Pennsylvania. Tobacco was not important here. Farmers focused on hemp, grain, cattle, and horses. Entrepreneurs had begun to mine and smelt the local iron ores. Sports occupied a great deal of attention at every social level, starting at the top in England. Hunting was sharply restricted to landowners and enforced by armed gameskeepers. In America, game was more than plentiful. Everyone could and did hunt, including servants and slaves. Poor men with good rifle skills won praise. Rich gentlemen who were off target won ridicule. In 1691, Governor Sir Francis Nicholson organized competitions for the better sort of Virginians only who are bachelors, and he offered prizes to be shot for, wrestled, played at backswords. Birth rate, low death rate, importation of slaves from the Caribbean, and immigration from Britain, Germany, and Pennsylvania. The climate was mild, the farm lands were cheap and fertile. Carolina's main articles, History of South Carolina, History of North Carolina, and Province of Carolina. The Province of Carolina was the first attempted English settlement south of Virginia. It was a private venture, financed by a group of English lords proprietors who obtained a royal charter to the Carolinas in 1663, hoping that a new colony in the South would become profitable. Like Jamestown, Carolina was not settled until 1670, and even then the first attempt failed because there was no incentive for emigration to that area. Eventually, however, the lords combined their remaining capital and financed a settlement mission to the area led by Sir John Colton. The expedition located fertile and defensible ground at what became Charleston, originally Charlestown for Charles II of England. The original settlers in South Carolina established a lucrative trade in food for the slave plantations in the Caribbean. Caribbean, the settlers came mainly from the English colony of Barbados and brought African slaves with them. Barbados was a wealthy sugarcane plantation island, one of the early English colonies to use large numbers of Africans in plantation-style agriculture. The cultivation of rice was introduced during the 1690s and became an important export crop. At first, South Carolina was politically divided. Its ethnic makeup included the original settlers, a group of rich, slave-owning English settlers from the island of Barbados, and Huguenots, a French-speaking community of Protestants. Nearly continuous frontier warfare during the era of King William's War and Queen Anne's War drove economic and political wedges between merchants and planters. The disaster of the 1715 Yamasee War threatened the colony's viability and set off a decade of political turmoil. By 1729. The proprietary government had collapsed, and the proprietors sold both colonies back to the British Crown. North Carolina had the smallest upper class. The richest 10% owned about 40% of all land, compared to 50-60% in neighboring Virginia and South Carolina. There were no cities of any size and very few towns, so there was scarcely an urban middle class at all. Heavily rural North Carolina was dominated by subsistence farmers with small operations. In addition, 1/4 of the whites had no land at all. Georgia main article. Province of Georgia. Savannah, Georgia Colony. Early 18th century British Member of Parliament James Oglethorpe established the Georgia Colony in 1733 as a solution to two problems at that time. Tension was high between Spain and Great Britain, and the British feared that Spanish Florida was threatening the British Carolinas. Oglethorpe decided to establish a colony in the contested border region of Georgia and to populate it with debtors who would otherwise have been imprisoned. According to standard British practice, this plan would both rid Great Britain of its undesirable elements and provide her with a base from which to attack Florida. The first colonists arrived in 1733. Georgia was established on strict moralistic principles. Slavery was officially forbidden, as were alcohol and other forms of immorality. However, the reality of the colony was far different. The colonists rejected a moralistic lifestyle and complained that their colony could not compete economically with the Carolina rice plantations. Georgia initially failed to prosper, but eventually the restrictions were lifted, slavery was allowed, and it became as prosperous as the Carolinas. The colony of Georgia never had an established religion. It consisted of people of various faiths. East and West Florida main articles. British Florida, East Florida, and West Florida. Spain ceded Florida to Great Britain in 1763, which established the colonies of East and West Florida. The Floridas remained loyal to Great Britain during the American Revolution. They were returned to Spain in 1783 in exchange for the Bahamas, at which time most of the British left. The Spanish then neglected the Floridas. Few Spaniards lived there when the U.S. bought the area in 1819. British colonial government. Each colony had a paid colonial agent in London to represent its interests. The three forms of colonial government in 1776 were provincial, royal colony, proprietary, and charter. These governments were all subordinate to the King of England, with no explicit relationship with the British Parliament. Beginning late in the 17th century, the administration of all British colonies was overseen by the Board of Trade in London. Crown Colonies main article. Crown Colony. New Hampshire, New York, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and eventually Massachusetts were crown colonies. The provincial colony was governed by commissions created at pleasure of the king. A governor and in some provinces his council were appointed by the crown. The governor was invested with general executive powers and authorized to call a locally elected assembly. The governor's council would sit as an upper house when the assembly was in session. In addition to its role in advising the governor, assemblies were made up of representatives elected by the freeholders and planters, landowners of the province. The governor had the power of absolute veto and could prorogue, i.e., delay and dissolve the assembly. The assembly's role was to make all local laws and ordinances, ensuring that they were not inconsistent with the laws of England. In practice, this did not always occur, since many of the provincial assemblies sought to expand their powers and limit those of the governor, and crown laws could be examined by the British Privy Council or Board of Trade, which also held veto power of legislation. Proprietary colonies main article. Proprietary colony. Pennsylvania, which included Delaware, New Jersey, and Maryland, were proprietary colonies. They were governed much as royal colonies, except that Lord Proprietors, rather than the King, appointed the governor. They were set up after the Restoration of 1660 and typically enjoyed greater civil and religious liberty. Charter Colonies. Main article, Charter Colony. Massachusetts, Providence Plantation, Rhode Island, Warwick, and Connecticut were charter colonies. The Massachusetts charter was revoked in 1684 and was replaced by a provincial charter that was issued in 1691. Charter governments were political corporations created by letters patent, giving the grantees control of the land and the powers of legislative government. The charters provided a fundamental constitution and divided powers among legislative, executive, and judicial functions, with those powers being vested in officials. Political culture. The primary political cultures of the United States had their origins in the colonial period. Most theories of political culture identify New England, the Mid-Atlantic, and the South as having formed separate and distinct political cultures, as Bonomi 1971 shows. The most distinctive feature of colonial society was the vibrant political culture, which attracted the most talented and ambitious young men into politics. First, suffrage was the most generous in the world, with every man allowed to vote who owned a certain amount of property. Fewer than 1% of British men could vote, whereas a majority of American freemen were eligible. The roots of democracy were present, although deference was typically shown to social elites in colonial elections. Second, a very wide range of public and private business was decided by elected bodies in the colonies, especially the assemblies and county governments in each colony. They handled land grants, commercial subsidies, and taxation, as well as oversight of roads, poor relief, taverns, and schools. Americans sued each other at a very high rate, with binding decisions made not by a great lord but by local judges and juries. This promoted the rapid expansion of the legal profession, so that the intense involvement of lawyers in politics became an American characteristic by the 1770s. Third, the American colonies were exceptional in the world because of the representation of many different interest groups in political decision-making. The American political culture was open to economic, social, religious, ethnic, and geographical interests, with merchants, landlords, petty farmers, artisans, Anglicans, Presbyterians, Quakers, Germans, Scotch-Irish, Yankees, Yorkers, and many other identifiable groups taking part. Elected representatives learned to listen to these interests because 90% of the men in the lower houses lived in their districts, unlike England, where it was common to have an absentee member of parliament. All of this was very unlike Europe, where aristocratic families and the established church were in control. Finally, and most dramatically, the Americans were fascinated by and increasingly adopted the political values of republicanism, which stressed equal rights, the need for virtuous citizens, and the evils of corruption, luxury, and aristocracy. Republicanism provided the framework for colonial resistance to British schemes of taxation after 1763, which escalated into the Revolution. None of the colonies had stable political parties of the sort that formed in the 1790s, but each had shifting factions that vied for power, especially in the perennial battles between the appointed governor and the elected assembly. There were often country and court factions, representing those opposed to the governor's agenda and those in favor of it.